Welcome to Calvary Chapel Eagle, a multi-generational church reaching people from all walks of life and in different stages of our journeys with Jesus. We are a local church with a global heart to show God's love to all and to see people renewed by their faith in Jesus and revived by the Holy Spirit as they restart and are born again to live out their God-given purpose. We believe the church is essential for spreading God's truth and love to a world in need, and that the church is its people, you and me. We are excited for you to join us as we worship together and study God's word. Church begins right now.
Welcome to Calvary Chapel Eagle. Thank you so much for joining us for Palm Sunday. Let's stand to our feet and worship Jesus together. Put those hands together. Sing this out.
This is where worship starts. Here in the temple of my heart, remembering who you are and all you've done. This is your majesty. All I have tasted and I've seen, remembering who you are. And once again
I see the Lord. We praise you, Lord. And this is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise. Come on. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. For fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lifts him high. With all creation
the goodness of God. Good morning, everybody. How's it going today? Yeah. All right. Hey, my name is Taylor. I'm part of the students team here at CCE. And hey, if you're a 6th or 12th grader at this time, I want to ask that you guys make your way on over to the Student Center. Stephen's at the door to help guide you along the way. And for the rest of the church, hey, why don't you find someone you didn't come to church with and welcome into church this morning? Let's make everyone feel welcome.
Calvary Chapel Eagle, how are you guys
morning,
doing
guys.
Today? Well, welcome to Calvary Chapel. We're so glad that you guys are here today. And also, would you help me by putting your hands together and congratulating Brad and Linda as today they're celebrating their 40th year wedding anniversary.
Let's go.
They're here today on their 40th anniversary. You know you've been married 40 years when you said, hey, there's no other place I'd rather be than in the presence of the Lord. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Well, welcome to church. It's so great to see all of you guys at church today. And can I just tell you how thankful and blessed my wife Morgan and I are to get to do life and ministry with you guys. We love you guys so much. And what an honor and joy it is for us to gather each and every single week together to study God's word and to grow in our relationship with the Lord. And we're just so glad that you are here today to celebrate. And if you are new to Calvary Chapel, well, welcome home. We love you guys.
Amen.
And we're so glad that you're here. And if you didn't stop by the first time guest booth on your way in, there's a white canopy outside the main entrance. Make sure to stop by there on your way out. They have something to give you just for visiting with us today. Well, Tyler, we have a couple of announcements.
We do.
We got something special next week.
We got some things going down next week, guys. Easter Sunday. Resurrection Sunday is next week. Not only that, but we're going to two services.
Yeah.
Which is huge amazing. For us as a church. Look how fast this is building. Look how God's working in this ministry. It's incredible. So, guys, the new times will be 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. Don't show up at 10. That'll be awkward for you. And, you know, it's... So 9 a.m. and 11 a.m., bring your family. After both services, we're going to have the Sea Kids go outside on the field, and they'll be able to do an Easter egg hunt. So either service will have that, as well as an Easter photo booth. So you can show up in your pastels, show how good your family looks to everybody on Facebook, spread that out, right? And then the Friday before, this Friday, we have our Good Friday message. Pastor Brenen and Morgan are going to be bringing that. That airs at 12 noon. But if you miss it, don't worry. We're going to record that so that you guys can watch it later. And then after service today, we actually have our communion cups, which you guys can pick up to take part in communion on the Good Friday message. Now, Easter's huge. So we want you guys to take all the invite cards that are out there today. We don't want to see any more. Make sure those are all passed out. These guys right here, we want you guys to give them to all your friends and family. And then on cceagle.com, you can screenshot or download the image, the You Are Invited image, post that to your Facebook or social media and invite people that way. It's going to be a packed house. Get here early. I'm excited.
Yeah, also, would you help me real briefly? There's so many people that are serving, making church possible for every single one of us. Every chair that you're sitting right now, someone set that up this morning. The stage, this backdrop, this gets set up every single Sunday morning, torn down every single Sunday. The flags out in the street to make it easy for you to find every single thing you see on campus. There's people that give of themselves to make you feel loved and cared for and tended to. And I just think what we know, we haven't really recognized our ministry teams all that much, but would you put your hands together and thank every single one that serves this church so faithfully? From the people that make you feel welcome in the parking lot and at the doors, we are so blessed to have the people serving that we have serving at our church. And listen, if you've been coming to Calvary Chapel Eagle for any length of time, and this is the place that you've decided to call home, this is the place that God has called you to be, I want to ask that you would prayerfully consider joining a team, getting involved in your church. As we're going to two services next week, there's some more opportunities, especially when it comes to our setup and teardown teams. Now, you don't have to have any training in ministry to be a part of that. You just have to say, hey, I'm able to wheel some stuff on some dollies. And as the teams unload things from the shed and bring things in, if you're an able body and say, hey, I'm willing to get up early, especially for you men to help, you know, set up some things. There's a few men that come very early on Sunday mornings because there's only a few men. They actually get here at 5 a.m. That means they're getting up in the 4 o'clock hour. And now I know you already decided that you're not gonna be a part of that team. But here's the thing. If we get some more people a part of that team, we can push that time back later and later. Eventually we wanna push it to the 6 o'clock hour, but we need a lot more people to get involved on that setup team. And you might say, well, hey, listen, I have kids, I have to help in the morning to get my family ready for church. Great, come early. Serve for an hour or two and then take off. You'll probably get back home right when your family is waking up, and then make them some breakfast, give your wife some coffee, and then help get your family ready for church. So best of both worlds. So hey I would just ask, we need you guys. If you're an able body and you're willing to serve, I know that the men really could use some reinforcements. And so as the Lord leads, not out of any obligation or pressure by any means, but if you don't sign up, you're not allowed here back next week. No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. But not out of any obligation or pressure, but if the Lord would lead you to say, hey, you know what, I want to do something to be a part of my church. That's a great way to get involved. And going to two services, we'll have a setup team, and then after the second service, there'll be a teardown team. Now, it's always easier to tear down after the second service because you're here and at the second service if you're a second service attender. But if you can, give some time in the morning to come and gather. You can sign up by going to cceagle.com/join the team. And if you go to join the team, cceagle.com/join the team, you can sign up there for the setup team or the teardown team, or Tyler's going to be at the back of the sanctuary. You can just go tell him, hey, I want to get involved in this. He'll help you get signed up to get involved today if you want to get involved for the setup team, particularly the setup team or the teardown team, but especially the setup team. And just get involved with what God's doing at your church.
Amen, amen. Guys, that's the move, man. Come home with some Starbucks after setting up your church. Your wife's going to be like, that's my man right there.
You know? I guarantee she'll love you more. Guaranteed.
Hey, there's so many ways to stay connected here at Calvary Chapel Eagle. We want to make sure you're getting our Connect Bulletin. So if you're not signed up for that, go to cceagle.com, scan the QR code behind me, or you can sign up at the Connect counter outside. That's going to just inform you of everything we have coming up. And also on a note on that, fellas, if you come to Valor, we're not going to Valor this Wednesday. That'll resume on April 3rd. So just a side note on that. We'll keep that going for our men's Bible study.
Awesome. Well, now we want to pray for our tithes and our offerings. If you desire to support what God's doing in and through this ministry, your tithes and your offerings are received at the boxes at each of the exits, in the hallway or at the sanctuary. Here at Calvary Chapel Eagle, you don't see a plate passed or a bucket passed, because we want you to know that we don't want anything from you. We just have something for you. And it's the Word of God. It's Jesus Christ. And we want you to experience Him today. But if you call this church your home and you want to see this ministry move forward, and you desire to support in obedience to what God's called you to do, and giving cheerfully and faithfully and generously, the boxes are available there for your tithes and your offerings. Or if you're like me and you don't carry a checkbook, and I don't carry a lot of cash on me. Actually, I never have any cash on me. Life of a pastor. So if you want to give online, you can give online safely and securely. You go to cceagle.com/give. You can sign up to give reoccurring, or you can give a one-time donation, but that's available there for you. But let's now pray for our tithes and our offerings. Lord, as we prepare to give to you, even during this next song, our own hearts, asking you, God, what is it that you would have for us to do? Individually and as a church congregationally, we want to see your work move forward. We want to see your work provided for. We want to see your work be accomplished in and through our lives. And so, Lord, as we search our own hearts, Lord, and ask you, Lord, what is it that you would have for us to do? As we prepare to give to you, Lord, we pray that you would use our tithe and our offerings above and beyond our tithe, that you would use it to accomplish your purpose for our church and the lives that you would want to impact through this ministry. Lord, thank you for this place that we can come each and every single week to gather together, to have this amazing community, to have worship where we're led into your throne room. Lord, to have a church that teaches the Bible unapologetically. And Lord, we're so blessed to have this place. Lord, this place, not just the gym or the four walls, but to be here together, to call this church our home. So Lord, would you provide for every aspect, every missions work, every outreach, every future thing that you have planned, Lord, that we don't know how you're going to provide for, but we just trust you that you'll provide for it all. And we give our church to you and our lives and our finances. And we give you all the glory in advance for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people say, amen. 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 Let's all stand together. We're going to continue worshiping. But I want to let you know of a couple things. After service, there's some coffee and donuts in the cafe. Make sure to hang out. Grab a donut. Grab a cup of coffee. Get to know some people that you worship with. And then also after service, up front here, there'll be some men and women available to pray with you. If you need prayer for anything, they would love the opportunity to join in prayer, either with you, for someone, or for you. If you need prayer for anything, they're available for that. Now let's continue worshiping our Lord. Are you guys ready to worship the Lord? Hey, let's raise our voices. Let's raise our hands. Let's proclaim the goodness of God now.
Sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayed, the sin of men and wrath of God has been on Jesus laid. Silent as salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Sent of heaven, reconcile the very ones who nailed him to that tree.
Sing it out.
Praise and honor unto thee.
Today we are beginning a mini-series called Easter at CCE, and we're going to be looking at the story of the resurrection. Of course, today is Palm Sunday, the day where Jesus made his triumphant entry riding into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey. And so we're going to look at that story. So if you have your Bibles with you, would you please turn with me to John chapter 12? John chapter 12, this is one of the few incidences in the life of Jesus that appears in all four of the gospel accounts, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. But today I want to look at the story from John's perspective today. In John chapter 12, and if you're expecting to hear from God today, if you're looking forward to God speaking a word to your life today, would you say amen? Amen. I hope that you're coming ready to receive what God wants to speak to you today. God has given me something so important to share with you today. I hope you're able to hold on to every word of it. I want to speak to you today on this Palm Sunday about how between the promise of God and the performance of that promise, that God allows there to be a period of time. And in that period of time, God is preparing that thing for you, and he's also preparing you for that thing. You might be thinking, you know what? I've been single long enough. I'm ready to get married. Well, God is preparing you for that person. And you might think, well, I'm already ready. Ha! That's what you think. No, I'm kidding. But maybe God's preparing that person for you. Maybe you think you're ready for that job promotion, but God is preparing it, whatever it is that he has promised for you and he has planned for you. God's preparing that for you while he's preparing you for that. So I want to talk to you a little bit today about that period of time that we often spend a lot of our lives in a message that I'm calling the waiting room. The waiting room. And let's pray and let's ask God to bless this time that we have to study his word together. Lord, as we gather together to sit at your feet, to hear from you, to know you more. God, as we've gathered here to learn of you and the life that you would have us to live. Lord, I pray that by the power of your Holy Spirit right now, that you would speak to the hearts and the lives of your people. More than just a word from a pastor, Lord, would they hear a word from you? And would you meet each and every single one of us exactly where we are at in our journey through life with you? Lord, maybe there's some here today that don't know you personally, and I pray that today would be the day that they would come to know you personally. Maybe there's some that have made a commitment to follow you recently, and they're newer in their faith. Lord, I pray that today you would meet them where they're at. And Lord, maybe there's some here today that have been walking with you for many, many years now. But God, I pray that you would reveal the depths of your truth and of your word to each of us today and give us the word that we need to receive for this day, for such a time as this. And we give you all the glory in advance for all that you're going to do. In Jesus' name, amen. In the society in which we live in today, we want everything fast and now. We don't want to wait for anything. I mean, just to prove it to you, if you've ever tried to stream a movie like on Netflix or something and then the wheels start spinning for more than like 1 second, it ruins our entire movie. Like, I can't believe there's an interruption to this. I can't wait more than 1 second for it to buffer. And we want everything fast and now. And that's why we have something called fast food. And we want fast food, and we pull up to the window, and we want it fast, we want it now, and if there's more than two cars in line ahead of us, it's an inconvenience to our entire lives, because it's not fast enough. Not only do we like fast food, but we like fast cars. We want fast cars. I don't know of anybody that's ever bought a car because of how slow it goes. Like, this car, man, my dream car, goes 0 to 60 in 4.5 hours. And that's the one that I want. Old Betsy, Old Faithful. She's been so great to me. No one ever picks a car because of how slow it goes or how least it performs. No, they want fast cars. We want fast food. We even have microwavable meals. Because, well, in the words of the lady that went viral, ain't nobody got time for that. We don't have time to wait for a meal to be cooked or even a meal to be prepared. We just want to throw it in the microwave and have it done. We even have express lanes at the grocery store. Heaven forbid you have to wait to check out when you go to the grocery store. So there's a special express lane for those who have 10 items or less. And if you're anything like me, even if you have to get more than 10 items when you go to the grocery store, I limit myself to 10 items per trip. Just so I can get out of the grocery store faster. Maybe you're like me. Have you ever been in that express line? And there's someone ahead of you. And they start putting their things on the belt. I know you do this because I do this. You start counting their items. 1, 2, 3, 12. 12. They got 12.
Attention shoppers. We got a breaker of the rules here.
And I know we do that because why? Heaven forbid they have two extra items in the express lane and slowing us down. You see, because of the fast-paced society and how we want everything now in our culture, we've lost the ability to wait. None of us like to wait. None of us think, oh, I just love to wait. I'll prove it to you. Every time a light turns red, we get upset. Ah, red light. Until the next red light. And then the next red light. How many red lights am I going to hit coming to church this morning? I mean, we hate waiting for the red lights. And maybe this has happened to you. Have you ever got behind a red light that seems like the sensor is broken? And you just sit there? It's the worst. Especially when there's no one else on the road. And there's no one there. For miles. And you're sitting there at this red light. And all of a sudden, you have this voice within you that says, just go. If you've ever been at 55 and Beacon Light, you know what I'm talking about. Just go. No one will know. Anybody ever tempted just to go through a red light? Man, we got a lot of dangerous drivers here at Calvary Chapel Eagle. Just advise as you leave the parking lot today. None of us like to wait. None of us like to have our plans held up. And in this culture where everything comes fast and we can get everything now at the touch of our fingertips, we can watch a movie, don't have to drive to Blockbuster anymore. And all the 20-something-year-olds are going, what's Blockbuster? That's another message for another time. But in the culture where we live, where we want everything now and immediate, it's no surprise to us that when it comes to the promises of God and waiting for those to be fulfilled, that we have a hard time waiting. But between the promise of God and the performance of that promise, God often will allow a period of time. It's what I like to call the waiting room. It's when we are waiting on God for the answer. We're waiting on God to intervene. We're waiting on God to provide. We're waiting for God to make sense of the situation that we're walking through. And we don't like being in the waiting room. We don't like sitting in the waiting room and having to wait. Why don't we like to wait? Because we don't even like the word wait. Just that comes with a sense of dread, a waiting room. You go to a restaurant, how long is the wait? Oh, we have a wait. Oh, don't tell me that. I don't like to wait. I don't like to wait in the waiting room of a restaurant. I especially don't like to wait in the waiting room of a doctor's office. Oh, with kids going to a doctor's office, it's the worst. And I just don't understand. Let me just vent to you for a moment. I don't understand why every pediatric doctor's office has play food. Where the first thing that kids want to do when they're sick with play food is to slobber on it. And then they leave it for the next kid to slobber on it. So it's like, don't touch anything. Sit here. No. No one likes to spend time in the waiting room at the doctor's office or the waiting room at the emergency office. Or, you know, if you're from Idaho, you won't understand this, but just three letters to prove that you don't like to wait. DMV. Now, I know you don't understand that if you're from Idaho, but if you're from any of the West Coast states, then you understand, you know, that was an all-day adventure, you know, to go there until G5,426,392 was called, and you would be up. We don't like to wait, but what I want us to see today is just because we are waiting doesn't mean that God isn't working. I want to share a two-point sermon with you today. It's not even going to be a three-point sermon. I decided to keep things simple for us today. 2 points. I want you to write these down and take these with you. Number one, when I am waiting, God is working. When I am waiting, God is working. It's a well-known verse if you've been around church for any length of time. Romans chapter 8, verse 28. We know it. We can recite it. But I want us to see it in a different perspective. Because it says that we know that all things, what? Work together for good. To them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. We know that verse, we can recite that verse, but what I want us to understand today is that what God is doing in our lives and preparing for us, even when we don't understand how it could be good, even when we don't understand what God is doing, that God is working it all out. God will use the waiting room to prepare you for what he has for you. While he's preparing what he has for you, And when we go through difficult circumstances that we don't understand, whether it's a tragedy that takes place in our lives, or a car breaks down, or the boss lets you go, or the relationship didn't work out, or you didn't get accepted to the university that you thought you were going to be going to. And when we don't understand, you have to realize God still has a plan. You don't have to understand it, but God still has a plan for it. And oftentimes when our plans look like they are failing, and when things seem like they are falling apart, when our plans look like they are failing, God's plans are still being fulfilled. And that's what we see in our text today on this Palm Sunday from John chapter 12. And this is what makes Palm Sunday so special. When we realize that what Jesus was doing on Palm Sunday was always all a part of the plan, even when his disciples didn't understand. You aren't called to always understand God's plan, but simply just obey his command. Let's take a look. It's John chapter 12, beginning in verse 12. It says, "The next day, the news that Jesus was on the way to Jerusalem swept through the city. And a large crowd of Passover visitors took palm branches and went down to the road to meet him. And they shouted, 'Hosanna,' or 'Praise God!' 'Blessings on the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hail to the King of Israel.' And Jesus found a young donkey and rode on it, fulfilling the prophecy that said, 'Don't be afraid, people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming, riding on a donkey's colt.' His disciples didn't understand at the time that this was a fulfillment of prophecy. But after Jesus entered into his glory, they remembered what had happened and realized that these things had been written about him." Palm Sunday is a day that we celebrate. It's the day that Jesus rode into Jerusalem and a massive crowd gathered in the streets, and they took palm branches, palm fronds, and they laid those palm leaves out on the road. And then on top of the palm branches, they would take their tunics, their overcoats, and they would take those off and they would lay them across the palm branches. Both palm branches and tunics, laying them on the street, what was a sign of homage to royalty. What the people were doing is they were crowning Jesus as their king. They shouted, "Hosanna," which meant save now, because they wanted Jesus to be their king, to lead them to victory over the Roman Empire that they were subject to currently. And so Jesus is our man. He's the one that we will follow. He has the ability and the power. They recognize that from his great works. And so they lay down in humility, in homage, acknowledging Jesus as royalty. And as Jesus was riding in, it would be customary for that Roman centurion or that Roman leader of the garrison to ride on a white stallion. It was called the triumphant entry. After a soldier would go and be victorious in battle and deliver the people from the enemy, that leader of the garrison would be riding on a white stallion, high and proud, flexing the power. But Jesus, in his triumphant entry, it gives us an interesting detail. It says that Jesus was riding on a donkey, actually a foal of a donkey, a baby donkey. Jesus is riding on a baby donkey. Now you have to picture this. Not even a donkey, a baby donkey. You know, I think we don't even picture this in our mind's eye, but I think when Jesus was sitting on the baby donkey, his feet were like almost dragging on the floor. And the disciples are probably thinking, what is he doing? I mean, he looks ridiculous on this donkey. I mean, his feet are basically dragging. It would have been better just to walk. I mean, at this point, he basically is walking. And maybe there would be some people snickering in the crowd, you know, like, oh, normally he's on a white stallion, but this guy's just on a baby donkey. But what the disciples didn't understand with what God was doing is that it was always all a part of God's plan. Matter of fact, this wasn't something that Jesus decided to do spur of the moment, but this was something that God had planned long, long ago, because over 500 years earlier, before this moment on Palm Sunday that we just read about, it was prophesied how Jesus would come. With exacting detail, Zechariah prophesies in Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9, exactly how the Messiah would enter into Jerusalem, written over 500 years previously. Listen to this, Zechariah 9, 9. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. With exacting details, Zechariah tells Israel, when your king comes to you, providing salvation to you, he's going to be coming on a baby donkey. And so God had this part of his plan, showing Jesus's humility, but not only how Jesus would come, but when Jesus would come. Do you know the very exact day, the date that Jesus rode into Jerusalem was prophesied hundreds and hundreds of years earlier in Daniel chapter 9. Daniel prophetically predicted the very day that Jesus would come into the city. It says in Daniel chapter 9 that when the commandment comes for the Jews to rebuild the temple, it will be 69 sevens. 69 sevens until the Messiah enters into Jerusalem. Now, Daniel prophetically predicts the time that the people are given the decree, that the nation of Israel, that they can go back and rebuild their temple, Daniel in Babylon, saying that in the future, the people will be released from their bondage, their slavery. There will be a decree that will go forth that will allow the people to go back. And from the date of that decree, it will be 69 sevens, which is 483 years. Now, using either the Jewish or Babylonian calendar, both 360-day calendars, that takes you 173,880 days. Now, King Artaxerxes, on March 14th, 445 BC, historians record that the decree that the Jewish people could leave Babylon and go rebuild the temple. And if you go forward 173,880 days from March 14th, 445 BC, it takes you to April 9th, AD 32, the very date that first century historians recorded was the day that Jesus rode in on a donkey into Jerusalem. Hundreds and hundreds of years earlier, over 500 years earlier, how Jesus would come, when Jesus would come, when the Savior would come into Jerusalem, it was predicted a long, long time ago, which shows us this today. There are no last-minute plans with God. Aren't you thankful when it comes to the plans that God has for you? God's not trying to put together some last-minute plans. Like, you give your life to Jesus, you're serving the Lord, and God's up in heaven thinking, oh, man, what am I going to do with him? Like, I probably should do something with her. Like, I just don't really know what, you know, what to do with that person, but I guess I got to figure something out. There's no last-minute plans with God. That God has your life, your purpose, the plans for your life planned long, long ago. The Bible declares that before the foundations of the world were even created, that God knew you. God has a plan for your life. But even when it's all part of God's plan, sometimes we don't understand. That's the place that I call the waiting room. In our scripture in verse 16 today, it says, his disciples didn't understand at that time that this was a fulfillment of prophecy. The disciples at that time, in that moment, when they were actually walking through it currently, they didn't understand what God was doing. And isn't that the case, how it often is in our lives? When we're walking through that situation or that difficulty or that tragedy, the thing that's unknown to us or we're not sure of, how we in our lives don't understand what God is doing. We often don't know how things could work together for good. We don't know why God is allowing it. We don't know how good can come from it. Isn't that often the case for us? That it was always a part of God's plan, but the disciples didn't understand. The disciples were in the waiting room. They didn't understand at first. But what do you do when you find yourself in that period of time that I call the waiting room? What do you do when you know that God has given you promises, but you haven't yet seen the performance of those promises? That God says that I will provide all that you need, but right now you don't see God's provision in your life. God says he'll never leave you nor forsake you, but right now you feel alone in your life. What do you do when you're in that period of time from between the promise that God has given you and the performance of that promise? Let me give you what we ought to do, what we can do, what we should be doing when we're in the waiting room. This is the second point. I want you to write this down. When I am waiting, I can be worshiping. When I am waiting, I can be worshiping. Notice what it says in verse 16, continuing on. It says, but when Jesus was glorified, after Jesus was glorified, then, when, after God was glorified, it was then they realized that it was all a part of God's plan. Sometimes you'll never understand what God is doing until you bring Jesus into your situation. Sometimes you'll never get why God allowed something to happen until you bring Jesus into that. And it's when we start to glorify God in our lives, it's then things start to make sense. Because we can spend a lot of our lives racking our brains, trying to figure it all out, and still coming up short. But when you look to Jesus, you realize it was all working out for good. That God had a plan in all of it. And if it wasn't for that thing that happened, I would have never been in this thing. If this situation didn't occur, God would have never moved me to this next thing that he had for me. And you realize God's plan was being fulfilled even when things seemed like they were falling apart. God's plan was falling into place. Sometimes we'll never understand God's plan until we bring Jesus into the situation. The psalmist declares in Psalm 121, verse 1 and 2, that I lift my eyes up to the hills. Where does my help come from? He says, my help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. The psalmist declares, you know what? I'm going to lift my eyes off of the problems. I'm going to lift them a little bit higher. I'm going to look to the Lord. And as I look to the Lord, as I look to him, there is where I will find the help that I need to get through whatever I am currently facing. I'm going to lift up my eyes. I'm going to change my perspective. I'm going to lift my hands. I'm going to glorify God. You see, when we lift our voices to the Lord, when we lift our hands to the Lord, it's a sign of surrender. The stuff that we're going through, the stuff that we can't figure out, the situations in our life that we don't like, when we raise our hands in worship and saying, God, I'm giving all of that to you. I surrender it all to you. When we raise our voices and lift our eyes and lift our hands, it changes our posture and our perspective. And we realize, although these problems look huge in our lives, although they can be somewhat blinding in our faces, God is so much bigger than all of those things. And so I can lift my eyes to the Lord. And when you start glorifying God in the middle of those situations that you don't understand, when you start worshiping God and praising God, even when you don't know what God is doing, even when you don't know why it's happening, no matter how difficult the problem may be, and no matter how or what you have lost, like the disciples, they didn't understand these things at first. But when Jesus was glorified, it was then they saw the plan of God. You might not see how God is working it all together for good presently, but when you look back at what God has done for you, you will see that he has been working it out all along. You might be in your waiting room currently, but when you worship from the waiting room, it's then you begin to see God's plan being fulfilled. It might take a week or two or a month or a year or a decade, Lord forbid, or longer. Abraham, he waited 25 years to see the promise of God be fulfilled in his life. But God came through in his perfect timing. Nothing is going to stop God. Nothing is going to keep God from accomplishing the plans that God has for you while you are in your waiting room. I love what Isaiah says in chapter 14, verse 27. It says, "The Lord of heaven's armies has spoken. Who can change his plans? When his hand is raised, who can stop him?" In other words, when God says he's going to do it, there is nothing or no one that can stop that from happening. God has the power to see through what he said he is going to do. That's why Job in chapter 42, verse 2 says, "I know that you can do anything, and nothing that you plan is impossible." Sometimes we plan things. We have big dreams and aspirations. And we have goals that we would like to accomplish in our lives. And sometimes we plan things that we would like to see happen that we just have no power of making those things happen. But that's not the case for God. Whatever God has planned for your life, he's already setting things into motion to accomplish that plan. And that's what Palm Sunday is all about. Jesus, when he was riding in on a donkey, accepting the praises of the people, he knew that would set things in motion for the religious leaders who would be on the side of the road watching, that they would see him doing this and accepting the praise for the first time ever in Jesus' public ministry, accepting the public praise of the people, knowing that that would set things in motion for his crucifixion just a few days later. And then ultimately, the greatest setup for God's greatest comeback. Next week on Easter Sunday, we'll be celebrating the resurrection. And you see, when things look like they're not working out, can you imagine being the disciples after they saw Jesus crucified? You know, a lot of attention goes to Palm Sunday and Good Friday, and then, of course, Easter Sunday, rightfully so. But we don't really talk about Silent Saturday all that much. Can you imagine being the disciples there in a locked room, afraid of their lives, with the shades closed just in case someone would recognize them and they want to put me to death because I was a follower of Jesus? If they put him to death, they're going to want to put us to death. And they were hiding in a room behind locked doors. No doubt what they thought was going to happen didn't happen. How could this be? But it was after Jesus' resurrection, when Jesus appeared to them behind locked doors, that they realized what Jesus had told them. Exactly God's plan would be fulfilled. And they went from hiding behind a locked door to publicly proclaiming to the thousands that Jesus Christ is Lord. How does that change? It's looking to the resurrected Savior. It's seeing Jesus for who he is. And every plan that God has for you in your life, no one or no thing can stop it. Morgan and I found this to be true in our own lives over and over and over again. There's no accidents with God. Everything is working out to accomplish the plans that God has, whether we see it or not. We've walked through a lot of things in ministry over the last couple of years. And looking back now and seeing what God is just beginning to do here at Calvary Chapel Eagle, it makes me realize that God knew exactly what he was doing when I had no idea what God was doing. That God had a plan all along. That God wanted to accomplish something. And I only share that with you today because if God has done it in my life and is doing it in my life, then God is going to do it in your life too. There's no favoritism with God. God's got a plan for your life, a purpose for your life. And God is working in situations that we don't understand presently. And we wonder, God, why would you allow this to happen? Why, God? Why can't this? Why not that? And if you're anything like me, I hate to admit it, but when it comes to talking to God, I'm a big crybaby. Well, God, if I was, you know, I'd do it this way. So many times in our lives, can't we? You look at me all judgmental. We know you do it too. So many times in our lives when we can't figure out why. And year after year after year goes by. God, why would you allow this? How can this be good? God, what are you doing? But if we can, instead of complaining and grumbling, to take that complaint and turn that into worship, you realize that every single situation that you've walked through in your life, God's placed a stepping stone down for you to step into all that he has for you. To bring you to the place that God wants you to be and to accomplish the things that God wants to accomplish in your life. We view the waiting room as an interruption to our plans, but God views it as a fulfillment of his plans. All things that Jesus does is for his purpose and for his plans. And it's so comforting to realize that God, he's working it all out. When we see life, at least in my life looks like a big, beautiful puzzle that hasn't been put together yet with some missing pieces. That's how I view my life. It's a bunch of pieces mixed up, some face down. You can't even see that there is a picture on it. Maybe some pieces are missing. You know, it's not even a completed picture. But God sees the picture of your life, my life, not as a puzzle pieces scattered around, flipped upside down, but God sees it as a completed picture. And God's adding one piece at a time to this picture. And when we look at that piece individually, we don't understand the beautiful thing that God is doing. But when God puts it all together, there's never been a time in my life where I've looked back. Over the years of my life and thought God didn't know what he was doing. God's always had a plan. He's always had a purpose. And so what do we do in the waiting room when we don't understand? Oh, we raise our hands, we raise our voices, we raise our eyes, and we praise God in the waiting room. Start glorifying God in the middle of the situation that you don't understand, and watch how then things begin to make sense. When our plans look like they are failing, God's plans are still being fulfilled. The people cried out, Hosanna. Save us now. The people's plans for laying down the palm branches were to be delivered from Rome. But that wasn't God's plan. God's plan was so much bigger than that, so much greater than that. The people wanted God to deliver them from Rome, but God's plan was to deliver them from their sin. The people of Israel were looking for a deliverer for that time at that place, but God wanted to be the deliverer for all time, for people in all places. That God wanted to deliver the world from their sin and to deliver them to heaven, not just from the Roman rule. And the people, the same crowd that went from praising him and saying Hosanna and praising God on Sunday, they were the same crowd on Friday shouting crucify him. Because Jesus didn't do what they wanted them to do in the time that they wanted him to do it. And the crowd often will go back and forth. God, I'll praise you when I see you doing what I want you to do. But can we praise God even when we don't see what he's doing? Because we know whatever it is that God is doing, it's going to be greater than the plans that we had for ourselves. The people, they didn't see it. But when we are waiting and wondering, church, we can know that God is still working. It's all working out in accordance to God's plan. The disciples, they saw Jesus riding on a donkey. What in the world is he doing? And yet, God had a plan. Hundreds of years earlier, this was all part of the plan. And everything was falling into the perfect place. It was the setup for God's greatest comeback. And church, no matter what you face in your life, no matter what you go through or what you've walked through or what you're still yet to walk through, know this. When you are in the waiting room, God is still working. And when you're in the waiting room, you can be worshiping. And I promise you, you'll see God's plan come to pass. It's only a matter of time. And then when you behold the resurrected Savior, things start to make a little bit more sense. Because you realize his love for you. That he loves you. He's given his life for you. And he's got a plan for you. So what do we do in the waiting room? I hate to wait. But whatever God has cooking up, it's gonna be great. There's a restaurant that used to have this motto because it took forever to get your food. You gotta wait for great. And I think it's so true in our lives. You can have a cheap substitute now. You can get some fast food, 60 seconds or less. But if you want something, I've been learning about smoked meat since I've been living in Idaho. If you want something great, you got to be willing to wait. And how true that is, for whatever God has being prepared for you, it's going to be wonderful. Let's wait. Let's watch. We'll see. God's got a plan for your life, for mine, for our church. We might not understand, but God's going to see it through. Amen. Father, we thank you so much for your word. Your word that declares to us hundreds and hundreds of years earlier that you had a plan for this day, Palm Sunday, for it to unfold just the way that it did. And the very day that would be your perfect timing was predicted. God, there's nothing by chance happening. But God, you're laying down the stepping stones to get us to where you want us to be. And so God, would you help us when we are in the waiting room, not to think that we're just sitting there as a waste of our time, but realizing you're using the waiting room to work in us something that would prepare us for whatever it is that you have for us next. And so, God, give us the patience that we need in this fast-paced society where we want everything immediately and now. Lord, would you give us the ability to wait for whatever you're doing? And, Lord, that when we're in that period of time and we don't understand what you're doing, it's hard at that time to worship you and praise you in spite of it. But Lord, would you help us to glorify you, to praise you, knowing that you have a plan in it all. And Lord, on this Palm Sunday, would you give us a greater perspective that you have a plan for our lives individually? For each one of us, you know us by name, and you're working out every detail of our lives. And Lord, whatever it is that you're doing, it's going to be great. And so, Lord, would you help us to be able to be those that worship you before we see it come to pass, just like we worship you after we see it come to pass. Help us to glorify you in our lives and in all that we do. In Jesus' name. Amen. And with heads bowed and eyes closed, I wonder if there's some here today in this heart of prayer that would say, you know what? My plans haven't been working out like I thought they would. Things in my life seem like they're falling apart. That verse I shared with you earlier from Romans chapter 8, verse 28 says that all things work together for good. But it's for those who love God and are called according to his purposes. That means when you are loving God in your life and you're following his purposes, not your own, but when you're submitting your life to him, it's then God promises to work all things together for good. Maybe today you've been trying to do life your way, to accomplish your will and your plans. But today God would say, I want you to surrender it all to me. Maybe it's your plans today as a Christian that you need to surrender. Maybe as someone that hasn't yet surrendered your life, or maybe at one time you did, but you've taken over the wheel of your own destiny, the captain of your own fate, and trying to be back in control of your life. And God would say, today I want you to surrender your life to me. I want to give you an opportunity right now to lay it at the Lord's feet and to give this situation, to give the waiting room to him, to give your life to him, and allow God to take whatever mess it is, whatever situation it is, whatever heartache it is, whatever that is in your life, and say, God, my life is yours. I surrender it to you now. And if that's you here today and you want to surrender it or your heart to him, I want you just to raise up your hand wherever you're sitting at right now. Just to raise up your hand and hold it up high. There's nothing to be ashamed of. God already knows. He just wants you to give it to him. It's a sign of surrender. Just raise up your hand. There's hands raised all around the sanctuary right now. Any others that just want to make this day the day of surrender to the Lord? And Lord, you see these hands, but more importantly, you know their hearts. Lord, we need you to be the author and finisher of our faith. So we give you these situations. And if you're raising your hand right now, I want you just to repeat out loud this prayer. Maybe it's a prayer of rededication. Maybe it's a first-time commitment to follow Christ. Or maybe it's just a time where you're saying, I want to surrender this to the Lord. And I want you to repeat this prayer out loud, and the church is going to join me praying this prayer out loud to surround you in this. Pray this. Lord Jesus, I give it all to you. My life, my family, and these situations. Be my Lord and be my Savior. Take my life and use it for your plans and for your purposes. I will follow you all the days of my life. I will worship you even when I don't understand. My life is yours. Take it and use it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's all stand to our feet. I wonder if we can be those who worship God before we see the fulfillment of his promise, like we do when we see the fulfillment of his promise. I wonder if we can be those that will say, God, thank you for what you're doing when we still don't know what he's doing. Have you ever seen God come through in your life? I know what you do because it's the same thing that I do when you see God come through. Oh, God, thank you. Thank you, God, so much. I praise you. I didn't know how it was going to work out. You worked it all out. Oh, perfect, God. But can we praise God that way before we see him work it out? God, I know you're working it all out. I know you got it in your control. I know that nothing can stop the plans that you have. God, thank you, God. I praise you, God. Can we worship God before we see him come through like we worship God when we see him come through? And maybe you're in that situation right now where you don't know how it's going to work out. You don't know how that relationship can be reconciled. You don't know how the marriage can be put back together. You don't know how you're going to pay for that next bill. You don't know. But can I just tell you this? Can we worship God today to close out this service like God has already come through? Can we worship God right now? Because when God says he's going to do it, it's as good as done. And God has already completed it. It's just a matter of time. So let's lift our voices to the Lord. Let's praise God. Let's glorify him as if it's already done. Because in God's eyes, if he said it, it's going to happen. Let's praise the Lord. God bless you guys.
Let's sing this out. Weekend church, feel free to stick around, hang out, or get prayer. God bless you.
Thank you for joining us today. We pray you were blessed by the biblical truths revealed in today's message. We are always encouraged to hear how God is using this ministry to touch lives. If God has been transforming your life through this ministry, or if you would like to help support this ministry financially, you can go to our website, cceagle.com. Being in a community with believers is essential to the life of a Christian, and we would love to be in fellowship with you no matter where you're joining us from in the world or in what season of life you're in. We hope you will join us again at Calvary Chapel Eagle.